مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم. مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم. يا أكرم الخلق ما لمن ألوذ به سواك عند حلول الحادث عمامي. ولن يضيق رسول الله جاهك بي إذا الكريم تحلى باسم منتقم. مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم. فإن
يقين عيني يقين حقه بلطف وعافية. It's a tradition of the Prophet where the Prophet makes a very important dua to Allah Ta'ala. Allahumma arini haqqa haqqa wa rizuqani tiba'a wa arini batila batila wa rizuqani ijtinaba. O Allah, show me in reality as it truly is and not how I perceive it to be, and show me falsehood as it truly is and give me the ability to show it. Show me truth as it really is and give me the ability to adhere to it, to follow it. And show me falsehood as it truly is and give me the ability to shun it. It's one of the most important things that the prophets come with, and most important of all our prophets, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, are correct perceptions of reality. And that's what one of the underpinnings of ta'allum ad-deen, of learning the religion, the realignment of the human being such that he truly becomes human, yani insan, which ultimately is an intimacy with the one who crafted him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we deconstruct the human narrative, although we hear constantly these opposing forces of good and evil in terms of the human narrative, the ultimate human narrative is about the relationship of humanity, the corpus of humanity, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I think this is important when we look at the next section in terms of prophecy, now that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has declared his prophecy's messengership to Butun Mecca, to the great tribes of Mecca. And we're going to see opposition to the call of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam quickly become the sort of rule of Mecca, the rule of Lord inside of Mecca. It's how does the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam perceive reality? And in all of this, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is aware that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as Allah ta'ala says, yumahhis. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in all of his tests, he is bringing forth believers, crafting believers. Just like gold has to go under very difficult circumstances, conditions, in order to become gold, that which is revered, quote unquote, by man. Likewise, the heart's true gold, as in the hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, "An-nasu kal-ma'adin, al-dhahabi wal-fidda." Human beings are like ores, metals, gold and silver. خيرهم في الجاهلية خيرهم في الإسلام إذا فقهوا. The best of those in Islam are the best of those in Jahiliyyah before Islam are the best of those in Islam, so long as they have correct understandings, correct perceptions. Okay, and that is the job of prophecy, which is to realign man with his true human condition, which is to know Allah Subhanahu wa Taala. What we see here, the weak and the oppressed, the followers of prophets. Yani, what we mean by the weak and the oppressed is that those who, without prophecy, outside of the context of prophecy, they are on the opposite side. They are the ones who are the downtrodden. They're the ones who have been abused and misused inside of any type of society. Okay? But what we definitely do not mean is that those who are following prophecy, that they are oppressed. Okay? Because the nature of prophecy is to bring them outside of that dichotomy of the oppressor and the oppressed. As we see in the hadith in the Sunan of Imam Abu Dawood, where the Prophet said, "Unsur akhaka zaliman aw madhluma." And here it's a clear sort of khitab, address of the Prophet speaking from without that sort of dichotomy of what we see in terms of social society, those who are oppressed and those who are oppressors, the zalim, the oppressor, the transgressor, and the oppressed, the madhlum. The Prophet said, "Help, assist your brother, whether he be oppressive or whether he be oppressed." What's important about that, he's speaking to the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala an, who are neither oppressors nor are they the oppressed, regardless of how it seems inside of society. Because if there is a dichotomy, which is quote unquote, it's Allah and them. That's how they see the world. They don't see the world in terms of opposing forces to them, because they see those forces as forces, whether they be good forces or evil forces, just rungs in a ladder of ascension unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ways of gaining proximity to He, Jalla fil'ula. And what I think what's important about this, when we sort of study Seerah, we look at Seerah with a more discerning eye, is that it informs our condition inside of each and every single age in which we live in. So we have situations that we currently face now as Muslims. We're Muslims, we somehow feel and are trying to sort of engender some type of sympathy or empathy towards our condition, as if we are oppressed peoples, that we're an oppressed nation, as if we are sort of an oppressed religion. And that is a very, very dangerous and erroneous way of seeing what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has in store for the believer. Okay, the believer is somewhat outside of that. And the believer, ultimately, what his relationship is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's where the struggle is. The struggle is against forces that prevent one from ascending unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the struggle also is to effectively use those forces that allow a quicker ascension, a quicker relationship, a quicker what? Proximity unto the Jalla fil'ula. We see a verse, perceptions of weakness, like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَالَ الَّذِينَ اسْتَكْبَرُوا لِلَّذِينَ اسْتُضْعِفُوا. In the verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the people of istikbar. And if you look in the Arabic language, they're very similar terms, although Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's employage of these terms, yani, is for completely different reasons. What do I mean? It's like istikbaru. The word istikbaru is from a word in the Arabic language, istaf'ala. It's scale, it's morphological scale. From the word kibar. And the nature of kibar, kibar is a attribute of the heart. It's arrogance. It is the what? It is the sort of, when the heart feels that it is somewhat better than others. That's the nature of kibar, what they call arrogance inside of the Arabic language. It's self-grandizement. Carries the same word kibar in the Arabic language. But the word istikbar, it is about when the attribute of the heart now takes control of the limbs of the human being. So the human being now is not arrogant inside of his heart alone, but he's now arrogant upon his limbs. Arrogant upon his limbs. He acts arrogantly, he behaves arrogantly, which is a very dangerous human condition, so especially for a believer. So long as a believer has arrogance in his heart, but it doesn't manifest upon his limbs. The likes of Abu Hamid al-Ghazali says upon death, muhis, the kibr, the arrogance is completely what? Yani crushed, dissolved. So somebody comes forth on the day of judgment, he doesn't have it. Because an atom's weight of arrogance places you in hell, an atom's weight of arrogance inside of the heart. Okay? But if somebody has istikbar, which is the nature of the people of kufr, described who were looking at those who stood, who were going to stand in opposition of prophecy, that is when arrogance, which is inside their heart, now manifests upon the limbs. Okay? They haven't been able to keep it inside of the heart and to sort of contravene in terms of their deed, and not to act in accordance with the negative dictates of the heart. These who are those who oppose the prophets, people of istikbar. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَالَ الَّذِينَ اسْتَكْبَرُوا. Those who behaved arrogantly, قَالَ الَّذِينَ اسْتَكْبَرُوا لِلَّذِينَ اسْتُضْعِفُوا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لِلَّذِينَ اسْتُضْعِفُوا. He puts this in the passive. And what he means by استُضْعِفُوا, from ضَعْف, which means weakness, that's what we're talking about, the weak and the oppressed, استِضْعَاف, here in the employment of Allah ta'ala in this verse, it means those who have who are perceived to be weak. There's a perception of weakness. There's a perception of them being the downtrodden and the oppressed. Not that they are, and not that they believe themselves to be oppressed or they believe themselves to be downtrodden. Because they, on the words of prophecy, are being forced to move outside of that dichotomy, as we'll see inside of Mecca. The Prophet ﷺ is going to force the companions to come outside of the dichotomy of what? Of the oppressed and the oppressor. Okay? But the chiefs of those of his people who scoffed said, we see you as nothing more than a human being like ourselves. This is their words to the Prophet, to Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam. And we do not see anyone following you but those who are the most abject of us, primitive in their opinion, badi ar-ra'i. And what we're showing here is that this is perceptions of the followers of prophets. It's not the perceptions of the followers of prophets of themselves. Okay, and the reason I'm just stressing this point, because that is the perceptions we have of ourselves as Muslims in the modern era, which renders us a defeated people and doesn't render us a lordly people, a people who are connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see, the oppressed do not define the what? The nation of Islam. And neither does the oppressor define the nation of Islam. But it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who defines the nation of Islam and the relationship that the nation of Islam should have with him, Jalla fil'ula, and likewise should have with him, his common man, whether they be oppressive or whether they be oppressed. We do not see us having any virtue superior to us. On the contrary, we consider you liars. And we cause the people fought weak to inherit the land, the east and the west, which we have blessed. And the good word of your Lord was fulfilled for the Israelites because they endured patiently. Which is going to be the message of the Prophet ﷺ inside of Mecca. How we move outside of that dichotomy is to become people of sabr. But we look at the verse here in Surah Al-A'raf, and we caused a people thought weak. They were perceived to be weak. But they're not going to be weak because they were. They istimdad, that their resistance is a different type of force, a divine force. The force that created the heavens and the earth. The chiefs amongst his people who were conceited said to those considered powerless, same thing, perceptions of a lack of power, perceptions of weakness, to those among them who believed, do you know Salih to be an emissary from his Lord? They said, we are believers in what was sent through him. Those who were conceited, not perceived to be conceited, but they were, an attribute that had gripped their heart, we reject what you believe in, they said. Okay? Right. So these are those who are going to be initially begin to gather around the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam himself. Okay, so these are the ones who are going to gather around the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That these are the initial followers of the prophets. And although in one regard maybe that they may initially be those from amongst the oppressed, they're quickly going to be forced by the teachings of the Prophet himself sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to move out of harm's way. Do you think that you will be left alone as long as they say we believe without their being tried? We did indeed try those before them, and God knows who were truthful and does indeed know who were false. So verse Surah Al-Ankabut, I the necessity of trials and tribulations for those who take upon the faith of what the faith of Islam, because that's where the metals are going to be crafted inside of what? The fairness of tribulation. The Prophet ﷺ said, prophets are tried the most, then those who resemble them most, then those who resemble them most. Okay? ثُمَّ الْأَمْثَلْ فَالْأَمْثَلْ أَشَدُّ الْبَلَاءَ لِلْأَنْبِيَاءَ ثُمَّ الْأَمْثَلْ فَالْأَمْثَلْ. Okay? The prophets in and of themselves. Because they're going to lead by example. Okay? It's not that the prophets are going to be exempt from these trials and tribulations, and such that their followers are going to be subject to trials and tribulations. But what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to subject the prophets first and foremost to intense trials and intense tribulations, the type of trials and tribulations that no other human beings are going to be able to bear. No other human beings. The Prophet, from the day they're born, are tried. From the day they're born. You say in theology that prophets ordinarily are born fatherless. They don't have fathers, with very few exceptions inside of the history, the continuum of prophecy. Some even say that they're born motherless, that their mothers die in childbirth as a rule. Or that they're going to die at a very young age, as we see with the Prophet ﷺ, where his mother dies at the tender age of 6. I mean, when he's to tender age of 6 years of age. So the trials of prophets is from the very beginning of their manifestation inside of the world. And such that the trial does not cease until what? Until the end. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَصَوْفَ يُعْتِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. That your Lord sawfa yu'tika. Sawfa yu'tika, this is in the midst of trials and tribulations. Sawfa yu'tika rabbuka fatarda, that your Lord will give you such that you will be pleased. This verse implies you'll be given in the akhirah. That you'll be pleased in the akhirah, not in the dunya. This world's not going to please you. And don't think these trials and tribulations are going to stop anytime soon. We see with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sayyidina Aisha, she mentioned about the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She said that when I saw the death of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I no longer related to trials and tribulations that go with death with the rank somebody has with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because he had a very, very difficult death, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And ordinarily somebody could come to the erroneous conclusion that that's a sign of a bad ending, how somebody leaves the world. But Aisha says, when I saw how the Prophet ﷺ left the world, I no longer said there was a correlation beneath what trials and tribulations upon death and somebody's rank with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, this is the nature of the lives of prophets. And likewise, those who stand firmly in the footsteps of prophets, they're going to be subject to similar trials and tribulations. But remember why? Because these are souls, real great souls that are being crafted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Great souls are always crafted inside of the furnace of tribulation. On the authority of Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As, who says, once while the Prophet ﷺ was praying in the surroundings of Ismail, Uqba ibn Abi Mu'ayt appeared suddenly and placed his garment around him and began to violently strangle him. So Abu Bakr came forth and took hold of his shoulder and pushed him away from the Prophet ﷺ and said, will you kill a man? Because he says, God is my Lord. Which is a clear understanding of saying Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala in these early days of Mecca, that the intent was to actually take the life of the Prophet ﷺ. And this is in full view of Butun Mecca. This is at the Kaaba in and of itself, that they could physically take to task an individual who, if even if you look at the Prophet ﷺ outside of the realm of prophecy, that he's blue blood Qurayshi, protected by what? The laws of Mecca, the tribal laws of Mecca. That this is something unheard of in Mecca, where what? Yani a Qurayshi from a powerful tribe, not only a powerful tribe, but one of the greatest tribes of war. Yani the tribe of Quraysh, there are 12 different tribes of Quraysh, as inshallah ta'ala, yani we're aware of. And of them is the tribe of Abd Manaf. And the tribe of Abd Manaf, as we look at it in the time of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is considered the most powerful tribe in terms of war. That's the, I say Abu Talib is going to say, when he writes, when he composes a great poem to the Quraysh, that our forefather Hashim taught us the art of war, where people who were skilled in warfare, and likewise the sister in clan, who's called Umayyah, who become the Umayyads. They're the two main clans of the tribe of Abd Manaf, who were from one of the 12 tribes of Quraysh. Okay, so these are people who know war, and to accost one of them, it could have sort of consequences inside of Mecca. But you see, the nature of what? Of prophecy, even intelligent people become somewhat irrational in the face of prophecy. On the authority of Khabbab ibn Arrat, and what we see here, again, is the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam forcing them outside of this dichotomy of oppressor and oppressed. Khabbab ibn Arrat radiallahu ta'ala is one of the great early companions, and one of the most knowledgeable of the early companions. He's one of the teachers appointed by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Mecca. As we'll see, that two houses are going to be created for the early education of the companions. One is in the house of Sa'id ibn Zayd, one of the 10 people guaranteed paradise, and the other is in the house of Arqam ibn al-Arqam al-Makhzumi, which becomes known as Dar al-Arqam, the latter, and Dar al-Sa'id, the former. Khabbab ibn Arrat, radiallahu ta'ala, is the primary teacher in Dar al-Sa'id. He's the teacher in Dar al-Sa'id who's teaching those early companions, especially those companions who have some type of connection with Meccan society. Either Meccan society ordinarily has recourse to these individuals on a daily basis, as opposed to those who are somewhat aloof from the society in and of itself. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, of those who had to engage society due to their vocation, their occupation, he placed them in Dar Sa'id, okay? And that's going to be led by Khabbab ibn Arrat, who himself is a blacksmith. And those who were aloof from society, ordinarily maybe those who were hunters, who did not really mix with society, or those who were even youth as well, never had an occupation, they were going to be sent to Dar al-Arqam. That's where they're going to be educated, inside of the great Dar al-Arqam. And that's headed by the Prophet ﷺ himself, who likewise is somebody who is aloof from society. Sayyidina Khabbab radiallahu ta'ala said, I went to the Prophet ﷺ and found him reclining upon his cloak in the shade of the Kaaba. What is important about this, what we're trying to see thematically, these are very difficult times in Mecca, and extremely difficult times. And if you're going to understand that, what is the Prophet ﷺ doing reclining upon his cloak in the shade of the Kaaba in a very, very difficult time inside of Mecca? It shows you here zero fear factor inside of the heart of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He is somebody, as we learn with prophets, who have what? This very powerful relationship and confidence in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, such that prophets, not messengers, the prophets as a general corpus, that the ulama say in theology, they have zero relationship with the khalq. That prophecy is all about the relationship with God alone. And that's why Sayyidina Izzuddin Abdus Salam, Sultan al-Ulama, he says prophecy is greater than messengership. Because prophecy has nothing to do with what? People, within people. It's all about Allah. Messengership concerns people. But every messenger is a prophet first and foremost. So they're reared upon that very, very unique and powerful relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, such that creation does not exist in terms of their what? Engagement with the what? The Lord of the cosmos. Okay? Then they can be what? They're elected to a higher what? A higher rank, which is what? Which is the dominant opinion, which is the rank of messengership, of which the Prophet is not only elected to that rank, he's elected to Ulul Azmi, and then he's elected to be what? The greatest of all of the prophets that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ever sent. Okay, here they are, full confidence, as we'll see inside of the hadith here in Al-Bukhari. I went to the Prophet ﷺ and found him reclining upon his cloak in the shade of the Kaaba at a time when we were undergoing severe trials at the hands of the idolaters, the mushrikeen. So I asked him, will you not pray to God for us? Which is extremely strange, that the Prophet ﷺ is not even raising his hands in dua, nor is he even commanding his companions to raise their hands in dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about what changing the condition in which they're in. Nor is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi commanding the companions to go and complain to Immat al-Kufr, to the leaders of Meccan society, to go and protest, to go and what write to their what? To their local MP in order for these types of what? Tribulations to be lifted from them. But this is about the crafting of real souls, crafting of real people who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ultimately grant victory through them and render these people what? People of Izzah Aziz, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Al-Izzah lillah wa li rasulihi wa lil mu'mineen. That this might, this power is for Allah, the messenger, and for the believers. What believers? The believers who've been able to withstand these trials without an iota of shakwa, any type of complaint to Allah ta'ala, and never mind to what? Even to human beings. You're not going to complain to Allah Ta'ala. There is no sanction for somebody to go and complain to human beings, period. Okay? So he sat up whilst his face became red in prophecy. It's a sign that he's extremely angry now. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ashuf, that the kuffar Mecca, they don't make the face of the Prophet Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a tan color. He doesn't get angry with the trials and tribulations of the people of Mecca because he has the great attribute of hilm. You see, they're yani, chaotic. And you know what I mean? Behavior towards the believers only increases the Prophet ﷺ in beauty. That's the prophetic attribute of hilm. One of the things that the books of old said about the Messenger of Allah ﷺ, that he had hilm, the great attribute that we'll see inside of the end of this period. Likewise, instilled the ziyadah in him with the descent of Mikael and Jibreel for the what? For the Isra wal Mi'raj. Okay, so he became red at the question for us to go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Where's your confidence in Allah ta'ala? Where's your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? There were those prior to you who would have their bones stripped of nerves and fleshed by an iron comb, but that would not make them swerve from their religion. Well, how are the Sahaba swerving from their religion here? It's just a mere request for dua, i.e. for divine intervention. Dua of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam maqbool. It's accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for divine intervention, just that their situation becomes somewhat easier. But now with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's going to see his companions killed. He's going to see his companions tortured. He's going to see his companions ridiculed. He's going to see his companions cast out of Mecca. He's going to watch all of these trials and tribulations sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, without his hands turning towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the burden to be lightened. And we see the momentous occasion where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam raises hands to dua. That's the great dua in the worst moment of his life, which he calls Ta'if. Okay, Ta'if is going to be several years after this, 10th year after prophecy, when he makes his famous dua to Allah Ta'ala as he's leaving Ta'if. And then, khalas, you see divine intervention descend and change what the entire course of how prophecy was taken at that point in time. Okay, the prophets raise their hands, note, because they're commanded to raise their hands. Okay? They are higher than the angelic forces. When we Allah Ta'ala makes us privy of the way the angels interact with Allah Ta'ala and the creation, as an example, we look at the angels inside of the womb. Al-Mu'akkal bil Arham, Allah Ta'ala sends various angels to do various functions inside of the womb with the fetus. Some of them, it's what? It's about embryo. Some of them, it's about zygote. Some of them, it's about mudra. Some of them, it's about the descent of the ruh. Some of them, it's about the determination of gender, male or female, at the hadith in Sahih Bukhari. 42 days, the Prophet ﷺ says, the angel comes and he says to Allah Ta'ala, Ya Rabb, dhakara untha. Male or female, 42 days. And then Allah Ta'ala commands the angel, such that the angel then, what, is the one, the intermediary of Allah Ta'ala, to determine the gender of the fetus at 42 days, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi said, which is one of the miracles of what, of the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, because that's 20-year knowledge of the world. During the last 20 years, they've understood that it's a 42 days gender is what is determined inside of the fetus. That's Sahih Bukhari 1500 years ago, the information of the Muslims. But what, yeah, well, we left it inside of Bukhari to gather dust. It's not, that could have been a great contribution of the Ummah towards what, human civilization. But no, we only stumble upon these facts when what, khalas, Western knowledge comes and discovers them. But the point being is, what did the angel say? Ya Rab. He's been sent to determine what gender, but yet, Ya Rab, my Lord, Dhakara Untha, constant turning back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said at the Nutfa, Ya Rab, Nutfa, Ya Rab, Mudgha, Ya Rab. Yani, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Alaqa, every stage you're asking Allah ta'ala, Ya Rab. That's the nature of the angelic forces. And that's why Allah ta'ala says, Bi'idhnihi Sirajan Munira, or Sirajan Munira. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam only acts Bi'idhnillah, by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, the irony of that is that when he raises his hands to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in dua, it's because he's been commanded to, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, la yantiq anil hawa. He doesn't speak of his own desires, in huwa illa wahyun yuha. It is what? It is revelation that is revealed unto him, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. God will indeed complete this affair, such that a rival would travel from Sana'a to Hadramaut, fearing none but God and a wolf in relation to his flock. وَإِنَّكُمْ قَوْمٌ تُسْتَعْجِلُونَ He says, well, verily you are a hasty people. Verily you are a hasty people. Okay, verily you are a hasty people. This is the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum wa arda. And there is no shadow of a doubt that what they underwent is by far greater than what we undergo as a people, as modern day Muslims, by far. Because they were khairun nas qarni, the best people are my people. So therefore they're subjected to the greatest trials and tribulations than any other people. But yet the Prophet ﷺ considers them under those conditions to be hasty. A people that had they been war and vanquished, there would be no deen upon the face of the earth. That's again the call of the Prophet ﷺ unto Allah Ta'ala, bi'idhnillah, abadr. That if this usba, if this small people, this small group of people, 313, tuhlak, lan tu'bad fil ard, you will not be worshipped on the face of the earth ever. The Prophet ﷺ says in his du'a of Badr, 313 people. This is pre-40. There is less than 40 individuals now who declare la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, yet he still calls them qawmun tasta'jilun. You're the hasty people, people who lack patience, people who have taken to the ajila, ahl al-isti'ja. You've taken to the what? To the fleeting, hasty nature of the world. With the nature of religion is to reject the world and to embrace divine commands. Okay, if only you were to leave for Abyssinia, consequences. We're going to see consequences of the likes of Al-Yasir as an example, who are going to be punished for their belief. Yani, these are people who are in riq and ubudiyya to some of Bakhzum, such that they were, they're going to be punished. Sumayya, Yasir, Ammar, the family, one of the great family of Islam, and that they become the first blood shed for Islam. Sumayya, who when she is told, she learns the what, the nature of prophecy, move outside the dichotomy, and she understands that only this, yani, what is this? It's all rifa' with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all being raised to Allah ta'ala. Sister, when Abu Jahl tells to her, ukfur, deny the religion, she spits in the face of Abu Jahl. Deny what? And Abu Jahl takes a spear and he places it through her privates. That's how he kills Sumayya, radiallahu ta'ala anha wa arda. Okay? Her husband's watching. Does that make him shake? No. And then he's going to, what, soon after, have the same fate. He's going to be killed because of a lack of rejection of the religion. Then they're the believers. Because what is this? It's Ammar radiallahu ta'ala an. When he sees this in front of him, he sees his mother killed and his father killed for a lack of rejection. Khalas. What does he do? He rejects faith upon his tongue. And then they free Ammar. And then he goes to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a very saddened state, informing the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about his state. And this is believers. You see, they're all different types of metals. And there's no doubt whatsoever at that point in time, the metal of Sayyidina Ammar ibn Yasir, yani, was a weaker metal at that point in time. Okay, he's going to be strengthened later. And it's an ajeeb, as Allah, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi is going to tell Sayyidina Ammar ibn Yasir. Because why did you say kufr? He said, kayfa wajadta qalbak? How did you find your heart? And he said, I found my heart favor upon religion. Prophet sallallahu alayhi said, do not worry. But look at the irony of Sayyidina Ammar ibn Yasir, that to deny religion, deny religion upon the tongue, which is permissible so long as the heart is firm, in order to ward off death. The Prophet ﷺ is going to tell Sayyidina Ammar ibn Yasir at Khandaq, Ya Ammar, taqtuluka fiyatul baghiyah, that you will be killed. And you're going to be killed by rebels. The Prophet ﷺ told Sayyidina Ammar, you don't flee unto it, you don't flee away from it, you flee unto your own reality. And the reality of Sayyidina Ammar, regardless whether it was Mecca or Medina, or whether it was at the hands of Muslims, and that's what it ultimately became, at the hands of Muslims who took the life of Sayyidina Ammar ibn Yasir in the great sort of civil war or rebellious wars of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that death was prescribed. Death was prescribed for him, but in the way that, in one sense, maybe he tried to avoid, but it ultimately came unto him, radiallahu ta'ala an, that rendered him from the greatest people, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, yani sabr al-yasir. When he's speaking to them, he's walking past, and he sees them being punished, sabr al-yasir. O al-yasir, be patient, be patient, be patient. Inna maw'idukum jannah, that your appointment is in paradise. That's when the Prophet gave that great family the great glad tidings of that. Sayyidina Wasumayya, Sayyidina Yasir, and Sayyidina Ammar radiallahu ta'ala anhum, warda, although Ammar's reality is going to be over 20, 30 years after this fact. Radiallahu ta'ala anhum, warda. Likewise, you see Sayyidina Bilal, and look at Sayyidina Bilal when he's been punished, Ramda, they said on the hottest day of the year, beneath a boulder by Umayya, and that one, all he says is, Ahadun, Ahad. Ahadun Ahad, Ahadun Ahad, Rif'a for Sayyidina Bilal, one of our teachers, in Tawheed, he says, look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he's stressing the same point in Aqeedah, he says, look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses this mujrim, this criminal, to raise his slave. Look at the perspective of it. Allah uses Umayya to raise Bilal. That's really what has taken place. It's not Bilal being punished, it's not Bilal being oppressed, but it's Bilal being raised with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ahadun Ahad. That's why Waraka ibn Nawfal, who passes by, and when he sees Bilal being tortured, he says, Ya Bilal, be patient. This is Waraka, Tanassar fi Jahiliyyah, the one who became Christian in Jahiliyyah, one of the Hunafa. He says, be patient. He said, if you die beneath this, I will take the place of your death as a place of worship, as a maqam, he says, as a place where I worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Becomes a special place. That's a place where the slave was raised unto Allah ta'ala. Sayyidina Bilal radiallahu ta'ala was asked, yani, why were you just saying ahad on ahad? You see, that's a bida'ah from Sayyidina Bilal. Where's he getting ahad, ahad? Prophet never taught him that in terms of the zahir. Where's he getting ahad? Sayyidina Bilal says, if I knew a better way to say, I would have said it. If there was anything better that came to mind when I was being quote-unquote tortured in the hottest day of Mecca beneath a heavy boulder, I would have said it. But all he could say was ahadun ahad, ahadun ahad. Look at the mother of Bilal, the trials. Mother of Bilal radiallahu ta'ala, who likewise enters into the faith, radiallahu ta'ala al-Habashiyah. And Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab is the one who tortures here. Sayyidina Umar, and Sayyidina Umar used to take a jilt, used to take a leather strap, and whip yani the mother of Sayyidina Bilal al-Habashi, radiallahu ta'ala an, until Umar, Umar is, machismo, Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab. That is a very powerful figure, Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab, over 7 foot in height, and he doesn't carry fat, Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab, that's a powerful man, and he whips the mother of Sayyidina Bilal, radiallahu ta'ala an, until he, khalas, Umar has no energy left. And then say the mother of Sayyidina Bilal looks at Umar and say, is that all you have? Is that it? And she's trying to whip her out of religion. And he gets tired before she feels pain. Radiallahu ta'ala anha wa arda. These are the early believers. But that is clear instruction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which as we saw in Hadith al-Khabbab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that he conveys. Except there are going to be those, because as we said, an-nasu kal-ma'adin, different types of metals, and one thing we know about metals, under the heat of torture, the metal can become weaker, can become laying. So some of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum at this point are going to find it very unbearable to remain inside of Mecca. Okay? Note from amongst the people, don't think that this is necessarily a weaker in terms of their constitution, because ultimately, usually, in terms of those who are going to be commanded to leave, they're the ones who have no tribal protection. That the Lord, the rule of Mecca, the tribal rule of Mecca, is not going to protect them. Okay? And whenever that happens to anybody, as an example, when it happens to the Prophet ﷺ himself, he's got to think of pastors in you. So don't think anyone's exempt from that. We're going to see the hadith in al-Bukhari of Sayyid Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala an, when Tame refused to protect Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala an, Abu Bakr gets up and leaves. He makes hijrah himself. He's out of Mecca until another one of the great Bedouin tribes, Ibn Dughunna, Ibn al-Dughunna, gives him protection. Let's enter back. Look at the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, after the death of Abu Talib. He doesn't enter. Prophet doesn't enter into Mecca. He no protection. Abu Talib has died. So what does the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam do? He goes back to the great place of solace, Hira. He just goes and hits Hira, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and he sends Zayd bin Haritha to enter Mecca to try and negotiate protection, tribal protection inside of Mecca. So what has taken place here is that these are people who lack that type of protection. Abu Dhar al-Ghifari and others, he sends them back out of Mecca. Go back, too dangerous for you. You're not a Meccan, you're a Ghifari. You have no tribal protection here. Abu Tufail al-Dawsi, the Yemeni, comes, becomes Muslim. Go back to the Yemen. Khalas, too dangerous. You have no tribal protection. So those who have no tribal protection, who are generally the slaves, the underclasses, quote-unquote, in Mecca, now it becomes too difficult for them. Those who have not died at the hands of the Quraysh, and now the Prophet ﷺ is going to send them, what, beyond the great Red River to Abyssinia. If only you were to leave at Abyssinia, as therein lies a king, in front of whom none is oppressed. It is a land of truth until God relieves you of what has befallen you. Okay? What is the purpose of this? What are the purposes of prophecy? With the Prophet ﷺ in the Muwatta of Ma'ariz, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتِ لُهُ تَمِّمَ مَكَارِمَ الْأَخْلَاقِ, that I've only been sent to complete the noble virtues of character. And again, the nature of good character, it is always crafted under hardship. That's where good character comes. We as Muslims, take the spiritual path or what have you, we can feign good character. But then when the lightest form of tribulation afflicts us, then khalas, suddenly where is that good character that we feign gone? Where is it gone? Okay, the reality of good character, it manifests in the midst of tribulations, not outside of tribulations. It's always in the midst of tribulation that prophecy will teach us. As Allah Ta'ala, when He speaks about the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ, verily you are beyond what is called tremendous character, خُلُقَ عَظِيمٍ. Allah Ta'ala says in Surah An-Nur about the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Okay? Allah Ta'ala does not ask the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to have war, or does not describe him as being of those of good character. Although the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam asked Allah Ta'ala for that good and beautiful character, anytime the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam would look in the mirror, اللَّهُمَّ كَمَا أَحْسَنْتَ خَلْقِي, oh Allah, just as you have made beautiful my form, he said, فَأَحْسِنْ خُلُقِي, then make beautiful my inward reality, my khuluq, my characteristics, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam would say. And Allah Ta'ala answered, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ, that your character is ala, beyond khuluq, attributes that are azeem, not hasan, azeem. We know the difference that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam never commands us with character that is azeem. His command is خالق الناس بخلق حسن, يعني أقربوا لي مجلسا يوم القيامة أحسنكم خلقا. He only commands the believers with good and beautiful character, but as for the عظمة, great, tremendous character, that is only for the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam alone. And that's because these were instilled, directly crafted by Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala in the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. As Imam Al-Ghazali radiallahu ta'ala an, in his 20th work of the Ihya Ulumuddin, which is about the conduct of life, he called it, the book of the conduct of life, how we conduct ourselves inside of this life. And the entire book is about the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, because that's the qudwa. That's the example right there, Al-Ghazali showing us, radiallahu ta'ala an. And in the beginning of Al-Ghazali, radiallahu ta'ala an, he shows that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he says about Allah, yani when he asks Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala for good character, then Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala manifests that character inside of the Quran and then instills it inside of the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, as we see in the Hadith in Sahih Muslim, by saying that Aisha says, كَانَ خُلُقُهُ الْقُرْآنِ, that his khuluq was the Quran. Okay, we see verses. On the authority of Ibn Abbas, who said, when news reached Abu Dhar al-Ghifari regarding the mission of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he told his brother, ride unto this valley and retrieve news of this man from me, who claims that he is a prophet who receives news from heaven. Listen to what he has to say and thereby retain unto me. So his brother left until he reached his destination and heard what he had to say, thereby retaining back to Abu Dhar and saying to him, I saw him commanding unto virtues of character, and his words are not poetry. That's the brother Unais al-Ghifari, is the brother Abu Dhar, he's the one who mentions this. What's the point? Is that when we hear the Sahaba, when they describe the actual conveyance of the Prophet ﷺ inside of Mecca, they speak about Tawheed, the oneness of Allah Ta'ala. They speak about the messengership that he calls unto, that he's the final messenger, the seal of the Prophet. And they also speak about Makarim al-Akhlaq, these noble virtues of character that the Prophet ﷺ was also calling unto, summoning unto, teaching inside of Mecca. And this is going to force in Abu Dhar al-Ghifari of those who khalas, he's of those who's going to what? When his brother gives him this message, he heads immediately for Mecca. And then he observes the Prophet ﷺ, Abu Dhar al-Ghifari said, I remained at what? At Mecca. And I lived inside of Mecca for what? Over 3 days. They're just drinking Zamzam alone. He was a poor fellow, Abu Dhar al-Ghifari radiallahu ta'ala anhu, just drank Zamzam. And he said, I actually gained weight. I got fatter when I was just drinking Zamzam alone. That's why the ulama, when they speak about Zamzam, and they also speak about with milk, two things, Zamzam and milk, they debate about whether it's what? A fluid or whether it's food. It's a debate about whether Zamzam is actually considered to be ta'am and not sharab. Same with milk. Is it ta'am or is it sharab, a fluid or drink? He got bigger drinking Zamzam al-Ghifari radiallahu ta'ala an. Till eventually he takes shahada at the hands of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Abu Dhar al-Ghifari just goes straight to Mecca, to Batul Mecca when he becomes Muslim, and he starts declaring the fact that he's a Muslim. Well, who's he? Nobody knows him inside Mecca. So they beat him unconscious. Abu Dhar comes back the next day and he declares that he's what? He's Muslim. They beat him unconscious. Abu Bakr sees him being beat unconscious and says, this is a Ghifari. You better watch who you're beating. You know, the Ghifaris, because they were stick-up men, highway robber men, who were on the caravan route to the Sham. He says that you mess with the Ghifari, and the whole tribe could destroy your trade. And it's at that point the Quraysh left him alone, Abu Dhar al-Ghifari. But the point being, look, zero fear. You see, he can go in the face of what? Of quote-unquote punishment exacted upon him. It doesn't prevent him from what? Declaring his faith, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, wa arda. The nature of those early believers, that's why Allah ta'ala calls them as-sabiqoon al-awwaloon min al-muhajireen wa ansar. Allah ta'ala calls them sabiqoon, those who are the foremost, al-awwaloon, and those who are first and foremost, from the muhajireen, those people who are from Mecca, and the ansar, those who are later going to become from Medina. They're the highest. If we look at all of the people who are guaranteed paradise, all of them without exception, they're from that group, every single one of them. That they're from the first people to become Muslim. Extremely special people. They were crafted, their metals were crafted under extremely difficult conditions. And they passed the test. They passed the test that Allah Ta'ala laid upon them. Okay? On the authority of Abu Hurairah, the Messenger of God Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, I was only sent to complete the virtues of character. On the authority of Aisha, we see this. The hadith you mentioned about saying Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu arda. And Abu Bakr is a Taymi, and the Taymis are likewise a very powerful tribe, but they're also seen as an ethical tribe. And Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala and also, we noted as before, that he's someone who has sway inside of Meccan society. Someone who's props, he's been given props inside of Meccan society. But it becomes untenable for him. Initially, Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala is going to be of those who's beating unconscious, absolutely unconscious. Okay, when his tribe begin to what? Relieve their protection of him. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala is at the hands of what? He's beaten at the hands of the Quraysh. It's just that he's unconscious. And when he actually wakes up in his house, he regains consciousness. The first thing he asks is, how is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And his mother says, you're asking about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and look at your condition. He says, verily I will not rest and I will not eat anything till I know how his condition was. Because the Prophet was Abu Bakr was alongside the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he doesn't know what happens to him. So his mother says, well, how do I find out? And she says, go to whom? Fatima bint al-Khattab. The sister of Sayyidina Umar, go to Fatima bint al-Khattab and ask her the condition of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the mother of Abu Bakr goes and finds Fatima bint al-Khattab, sister of Umar, the wife of Sa'id ibn Zayd. And when she finds Fatima bint al-Khattab, she says, how is Muhammad, the son of Abdullah al-Hashimi? And to which Fatima bint al-Khattab says, who? And who are you speaking about? Who are you asking about? And what's interesting about that is the Sahaba, it shows again the difficulty of those times, that to become a Muslim, to proclaim your Islam, to tell people about your Islam, no. Tell people you even know the Prophet silence. Fatima bint al-Khattab, no. She's keeping silent upon it. Who are you speaking about? I don't know who you're asking about. And then what? And then she says, I'm the mother of Abu Bakr, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, Abu Bakr ibn Abi Quhafa. I need to know about, he's asking about Muhammad Abdullah. She goes, I don't know who you're asking about, but let me go and see your son. And maybe your son can has something else to say. So Fatima follows the mother of Abu Bakr. And when she gets to Abu Bakr, Abu Bakr says, how is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And Fatima looks at Abu Bakr, and Abu Bakr looks at his mother and says, no, she's cool. Don't worry, my mother's cool. Yeah, your mother's okay. And then she says, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is okay. He's fine, he's not injured. This Abu Bakr, the beginnings, that he ultimately realizes that it's going to become untenable for him. This is what we see in Sahih al-Bukhari, where Aisha is right, he's going to tell us. So long as I can remember, both of my parents were practicing the religion of Islam. So Aisha, the daughter of Abu Bakr. And the day never passed, save that the Messenger of God sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would visit us by night and by day. So when the Muslims were tried, Abu Bakr left in the direction of Abyssinia, made hijrah, thereby reaching Barak al-Ghimad, where he met Ibn al-Dughunna, the chief of Al-Qara, one of the great sort of Bedouin tribes. He asked, where do you intend, O Abu Bakr? And Abu Bakr replied, my people have cast me out, so I desire to wander the earth, worshipping my Lord. Okay? He's a spiritual tourist, as they say. Sayyahuna. Ibn al-Dughunna said, the likes of you do not leave, nor are they cast out. Showing his standing not only in Mecca, but also in Western Arabia. As you indeed provide for the downtrodden, maintain bonds of kinship, carry the burden of the weak, treat guests well, and assist in times of truth. I am your protector, retain back and worship your Lord in your homeland. The beauty of this, what is Ibn al-Dughunna speaking about? Makarim al-Akhlaq. The same five attributes Khadija recognized in the Prophet at the descent of Gabriel. In Sahih al-Bukhari, exact same five, Ibn al-Dughunna also in Bukhari, recognizes those attributes inside of Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala. And that's what's being transferred. Remember, there's no salah, there's no zakah, there's no psalm, there's no hajj, there's none of that. It's makarim. They worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala based upon attributes. And that, although that is something that is not la yunsakh, la tunsakh, something that's never going to be what? Abrogated, period. So he retained Ibn al-Dughunna, traveling alongside him. Ibn al-Dughunna thereby visited notables of Quraysh, because he's going to negotiate the deal with the Quraysh, saying to them, the likes of Abu Bakr do not leave, nor are they cast out. Would you cast out a man that provides for the downtrodden, maintains bonds of kinship, carries the burden of the weak, treats guests well, and assists in times of truth? Would you do that? Don't you recognize the virtues that this man has? The Quraysh don't say, well, what's virtues got to do with us? They don't reject the words of Ibn al-Dughunna, a chief, somebody who holds power inside of Arabia. So the Quraysh accepted the protection of Ibn al-Dughunna, saying to him, order Abu Bakr to worship his Lord in his house, praying therein and reciting whatever he wants. Meaning, so long as religion is a private affair, this is Europeanism right here. So long as you keep it to the confines of your homes, it's all good. But if you're going to display it inside of society, call to it inside of society, impose your values, your ways upon the good nature of our people, then we have a problem with that. And that's what the Quraysh are going to say to Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, warda. Okay? He should not harm us with it, nor should he display it in public, as indeed we are concerned that he will corrupt our women folk, like the Guardian and all of them, the Independent and the Times, all running wire sort of, women in English society all becoming Muslim. If someone's corrupting the good women folk, and likewise the children, okay? Look at the intelligence of the believers. Here of saying Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Ibn al-Dughunna thereby conveyed this to Abu Bakr, so Abu Bakr remained worshipping his Lord in his home without praying in public and reciting in other than his home. Okay, I'll listen to what you've got to say. Then it became clear, this is a fatah of Abu Bakr. Ah, I understand. Why? I'm a da'i. I've been sent to convert. I've been raised to convert. And this is a test that Allah Ta'ala is subjecting me to. So it became clear to Abu Bakr. So he built a mosque in the courtyard of his house. The beauty of it. It's probably the first mosque built in Islam. The mosque that we have in history, the mosque of Abu Bakr, that he built in Mecca, in the courtyard of his house. Don't think about a courtyard that is walled. Don't think about a mosque that is walled. This is just something that protects him from the elements, from the sun of Arabia. And everybody can watch Abu Bakr worshiping his Lord in the confines of his own house. The beauty of the intelligence of Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu arda. And he knows he's putting himself at risk on this, praying therein and reciting the Quran. Look at the Quraysh, they know their people. They say, Ahlul Mecca, Adra bi Shi'abiha. The people of Mecca know the nooks and crannies of Mecca best. They know their people best. So they understood what was going to happen and what was taking place inside of Mecca. The womenfolk and the children of the idolaters used to soil it. They would come and trash his mosque, throw things at Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, bewildered by him and staring at him. I mean, what are those stages? First they're going to trash it, and then Abu Bakr, and he's still there in dhikr, worshipping Allah ta'ala. Then they start scratching their heads, nothing do we do. And he doesn't deter them from what he's doing. And then they become intrigued by him. And this is the beginning of the conversion of the hearts of those people inside of Mecca. Abu Bakr was a man prone to tears, as we know. So that's why Aisha later on in prophecy, towards the end of the life of the Prophet ﷺ, didn't want Abu Bakr to lead the prayer. He starts reciting Quran, he's overcome with tears. His heart is extremely tender, radiallahu ta'ala, and unable to control his eyes whenever he recited the Quran. This caused great heart alarm amongst the notables of Quraysh, so they summoned Ibn al-Dughunna, who came unto them, bring the chief back. They thereby said, verily we protected Abu Bakr based on your protection, on the condition that he would worship his Lord in the confines of his home, and he has gone beyond that. You see, no, he's not doing that no more. Building a mosque in his courtyard and praying and reciting in public. We fear that he will corrupt our womenfolk and children. If he agrees to worship his Lord in the confines of his house, then let it be. Otherwise, if he refuses deciding to proclaim it, then request that he relinquishes your guarantee of protection. For verily we are averse to breaking your agreement. We won't go against you, but this ain't fair. But at the same time, we will not settle for Abu Bakr's flaunts. He's just flaunting it under your protection. But look at the believers, what the Prophet ﷺ crafts in the hearts of great people. Aisha said, Ibn Dughunna thereby went unto Abu Bakr and said, you are well aware of what we agreed, what the agreement was. So either you confine yourself to that or you relinquish my protection, as I do not want the Arabs to hear that I broke an agreement that I had contracted with a man. So Abu Bakr said, therefore I relinquish your protection and remain content with the protection of God. Mighty and sublime is He. And Abu Bakr is thereby embedded in Mecca. No protection by Ibn Dughunna and Al-Qara, no protection by Taym. His protection is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why the Prophet ﷺ said, "Lo wuzina iman Abu Bakr." With the iman of Abu Bakr to be weighed with the iman of the entire ummah, la rajaha imanu Abu Bakr. That the faith of Abu Bakr would outweigh the faith of all of us combined. The greatness of this individual, radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda. We see the hadith here of Abu Darda. Whilst we were with the Messenger of God revising what we were undergoing, he suddenly said, if you ever hear that a mountain has been uprooted from its place, then believe it. However, if you hear that a man has changed his character, then belie it, as verily one tends towards that which comes natural to them. It's the nature of character, that's why it's called khuluq in the Arabic language, khuluq. Okay? Khuluq is what? How you were created, that which comes natural to you. Okay? And part of what? The test in Mecca is to unearth the innate disposition of these early people. And likewise, consequently, for each and every single believer, if you hear that a mountain is uprooted from its place, then you can believe that. As for a human being changing his character, never. Character never changes. Like Imam Shafi'i, radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda, Imam Shafi'i said, when I went to Sana'a, I arrived in Sana'a, I saw an individual. Individual met me, and as soon as I saw him, I said, this man is miserly. He loves the dunya. Imam Shafi'i, he said he had the gift of firasa, he could gaze into somebody and see their reality. He said, miserly, he loves the world. And then the man says, you look strange to Sana'a. And he says, yes, I'm Qureshi, visiting Sana'a. And he says, no, khalas, marhaba, nuzul indana, tafadul indana, you're going to live with me. So Imam Shafi'i says, ajeeb. And then Shafi'i said, when he goes to his house, the man puts him up in his house, and the man what? Gives him great food, great hospitality. Imam Shafi'i said, I got to give this firasa business up, because I sussed out, the man was stingy and loved the world, and look how he's treating me. And then Imam Shafi'i, then after 3 days, Imam Shafi'i said, I have to leave now, I have business in Sana'a. And Imam Shafi'i said, when I'm leaving outside the door, the man says, where are you going? He said, I have to leave. And he says, I've just treated you well for 3 days and you can't even repay me. You can't even pay me for all the good hospitality I gave you. And Imam Shafi'i said, I was so happy at that point in time, at his reaction, because it meant that khalas, I still had the gift of firasa. Okay, if you don't change, people don't change their character. Leopards don't change their spots. Humans don't change their character. On the authority of Abdullah ibn Amr, who said the Messenger of God was not lewd, nor was he perceived as such. He used to say, verily the best of you with God is the best of you in character. Okay, do we see any difference between the character of the Prophet before and the character of the Prophet after? You don't hear of a change in character in the Messenger of Allah. Do you hear of a change in character in terms of whom? Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq before or after? You don't hear of that. We'll see the tradition of Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab. He himself, speaking about himself, my character doesn't change. It's just the motives that change, not the character. Static nature of human beings, okay? And that's why religion ultimately is about unearthing our real selves. It's about using the prophetic mirror to see who we are inside of that great mirror in of itself.
In that case, like, what hope is there for people who feel that they've got bad character traits? If a person feels they've got bad character traits, what hope is there for them?
It's for on a human being thereby to take his character of two types. Those which he believes are good and display them, and those which he believes are bad to what? To him, hold them in, to prevent them from manifesting. That's like when we spoke about kibr and istikbar. So long as you can keep it in, then it's khalas. And you're rewarded for that. And it's a great struggle to what to keep in, to not display things that are foul inside of you. Okay? So that's the hope there. Okay? But at a more profound level, that character which retains back to three things, retains back to intellect, retains back to anger, and retains back to passion, desire. Every single character trait retains back to one of those three things. And all of those three things, correct motives, correct intentions, can always be good. Okay? So, what bad character trait do you have? Oh, I'm really quick-tempered. Tell you, not good to be quick-tempered, unless you're quick-tempered for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, it's quick-tempered for yourself? No. But if it's quick-tempered for Allah ta'ala, yes. That's a good attribute right there. So to use that, what's so-called a bad attribute, and to use it, there's always going to be a good outlet for it. Okay? And there's always a bad outlet for it. Just like there's a good outlet for, like, you see, this, like, Abu Dujana, radiallahu ta'ala, at Uhud, where he starts dancing, and he displaying the swagger, really arrogant. That was istikbar, what he was doing. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Abu Dujana, he says, what you are doing, Allah ta'ala detests, except here. This is the only situation Allah loves it. And that's why we only hear Abu Dujana. The only place that he did do it was there. So the underlying point there is that what? Even something which Allah ta'ala detests, Allah can love it if it's done in the correct situation. That's the nature of all character traits here. On the authority of Abu Darda, the Prophet said, there is nothing more weighted on the scales of the believing servant on the day of judgment than good character. Verily God exalted be, he detests a lewd and foul-mouthed person. Authority of Aisha said, verily the believer will attain through his good character the rank of one who prays and fasts. And that was the prayer and the fast of those inside of Mecca. Sayyidina Umar said, I am still characterized with anger, although in the beginning it used to be in defense of disbelief. But it is now in defense of Islam. Same trait, just with the motive. Okay? Does anyone have any questions, inshallah ta'ala? Any questions? How long do I have? How long? Does anyone have any questions?
So, your character, can you actually improve upon your character? Not as in the set defined character which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set you with, but you can you work upon it to better yourself?
You're working upon it. That's why the Prophet speaks about human beings being metals. That's a really profound metaphor. Okay, you work on it by unearthing the real you, unearthing your character. Okay, it's a direct reflection of your physical form. Can you alter your physical form? That's why the same way khalq is your physical form, khuluq is your inward form. And they're direct, reflective. There's only small elements of our physical form that are what prone to alteration. Your hair, okay? Facial hair, your nails, very few. Khisal al-fitra, okay? So ordinarily, no, you cannot alter your character. But you can unearth it, the real character. And thereby, it's about displaying it when Allah Ta'ala deems it beautiful. And what? And preventing it from manifesting when Allah Ta'ala deems it to be ugly. That's the test of the human being. Any questions? Here the Quranic character. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, when the Messenger of God sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gazed into a mirror, he would say, "Oh God, as you have made beautiful my form, so make beautiful your character." And I think, inshallah, we all sort of gathering what the parallel is here, that this is what's upon us, okay? Upon us, Muslims, especially who live in lands which are ordinarily characterized by disbelief. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ultimately want to see from those who profess His faith? That He wants to see people of exemplary character, of beautiful character, in the face of opposition, in the face of ridicule, in the face of, He wants to see the beauty of Islam become manifest on human beings. Because Islam, you know, we can mashallah, perfect beautiful books about Islam, beautiful art that represents Islam. But the most beautiful thing you can perfect is your own character that's displayed through your heart, yani. And that's what Allah Ta'ala wants, okay? Oh God, as you have made beautiful my form, so make beautiful my character. Okay? On the authority of Qutbah ibn Malik, the Messenger of God Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to say, "Oh God, verily I take refuge in you from reprehensible character." Hadith in Tirmidhi. On the authority of Sa'ad ibn Hisham ibn Amir ibn al-Ansari, who said, "I visited Aisha and asked her about the character of the Messenger of God sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." So she replied, "Do you not recite the Qur'an?" I replied, "Indeed." She said, "His character was the Qur'an." كَانَ خُلُقُهُ الْقُرْآنِ. Another riwayah, our mother Aisha said, "كَانَ الْقُرْآنِ يَمْشِي بَيْنَ النَّاسِ." He was a Qur'an that walked amongst people, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's why we see Abdullah ibn Mas'ud ibn Abd, who said that the Sahaba, as they approached the Qur'an with 10 verses at a time, 10 verses, which they would learn, memorize and embody those 10 verses. And they said, we would not go beyond 10 verses until we'd completed that process. Okay? And that's why when we get to the Sahaba themselves, radiallahu ta'ala an, which is amazing, the greatest generation, you see, that we find that the ulama say less than 10 Sahaba memorized the entire Qur'an. 124,000 of them, less than 10, were Hufad of the Qur'an. You see, because their approach to the Qur'an was radically different to our approach to the Qur'an. It was not about being able to regurgitate the book in an audible way, but it's prophecy, ulama ummati ka'anbiya, like the prophets of Banu Israel. It's to walk the Qur'an, to live the Qur'an. It's really important difference, really important difference. That's, you know, Paulo Freire calls the pedagogy of the oppressed. This is the pedagogy of the blessed, right here. The pedagogy of the blessed here. Now how do we realize, live the Qur'an inside of ourselves? And so how was Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala, of those who memorized the entire Qur'an, he was Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, when Sayyidina Umar would send people to the qafilas, to the caravans that would come from Iraq, they would ask questions to the ones who were leading the caravans. He would come back, the Messenger of Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab, with the words verbatim of what the person had said. And every word that he said was Qur'anic. Either man spoke with the Qur'an, Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab says, "Go back, it's an alim." That's an alim, that's someone speaking with the Qur'an. Any word you ask him, he'll only reply through verses of the Qur'an. When he went back, who was it? Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala. He used to speak with the Qur'an. And it's amazing. Some people used to make that as part of their tarbiyah to Allah Ta'ala. From amongst them, whom? Famous person of the 20th century, Hassan al-Banna. Hassan al-Banna went through a period of his life where he would only speak Qur'an. That's it, khalas, no other words would manifest upon his tongue. It's a powerful attribute in a very, really blessed and a gigantic person of this ummah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raise in degrees. Okay? So it is because of mercy from God that you were mild with them. Had you been harsh and hard-hearted, they would have dispersed from around you. So pardon them and seek forgiveness for them and consult with them in matters of concern. Then when you make a decision, trust in God, for God loves the trusting. Amazing verse. Yani rahmatun min Allah linta lahum, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. It is because of mercy from God, linta lahum, that you are layyin. Yani essential characteristic, lean. And that characteristic is ordinarily for whom? The most harshest and obstinate of people. That's why Allah ta'ala sends whom? He sends Moses and Harun, Aaron, alayhim as-salam, to Fir'aun. وَقُولَ لَهُ قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا. Speak to him with lean, layyin. Allah ta'ala instructed Moses, of all whose character, no doubt whatsoever, is rather sort of rough at the edges, saying to Musa alayhi salam, saying the Prophet alayhi salam saw Moses on Isra al-Mi'raj, and he was being very harsh in some type of communication in his grave, a kathib al-ahmar. And the Prophet alayhi salam asks Jibreel, who's Musa speaking to? And Jibreel says, Allah. He's speaking to Allah. And the Prophet alayhi salam says, speaking to Allah in a very harsh manner, he can do that. And Jibreel alayhi salam said, Allah created Moses and he knows the nature of Moses. Ay Allah, don't take it personally. Moses is being himself, true to himself, alayhi salam. Okay? But the Prophet alayhi wasallam, that lean, he's being true to himself. That rahmah, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ, when he said he was a mercy to the world, he's being true to himself. Sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahihi wa sallam. Had you been harsh, created harsh. Hard-hearted, created with a hard heart, they would have dispersed from around you. And فَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. Okay? فَعْفُوا عَنْهُمْ. Look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَعْفُوا عَنْ مَنْ. Who should you pardon? عَفُوا. Who should you have عَفُوا for? And who is he speaking about? Yani, bad people. That's who we're speaking about. Those who are against prophecy. Allah Ta'ala saying the reason why they're even giving you play is because of your innate nature. Then Allah says, fa'afu anhum, not faghfir lahum. Fa'afu anhum, first and foremost, what is that? That erase it from your memory. Don't take anything personally. Don't hold it against. That's what afu is. Afu is higher than forgiveness. Forgive is that you forgive what you don't forget. And when Allah Ta'ala forgives, but he doesn't forget. He just puts a veil. That's all he does. Afu, Allah minnaka afu. Oh Allah, you are afu. Name of the Divine Jalla fil'ula. He forgives and he forgets. That's what afu is. And that's what Allah Ta'ala is telling the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He said, fa'afu anhum, wastaghfir lahum. And if they show afu and seek forgiveness for them, then what's even ajib? Ushawirhum fil amr. Take their counsel, seek their advice on matters of what type of people. This is yani, prophetic. What kind of the rest of that last one is the reality of hilm. These are the three darajat of what? Although there are five, because Allah Ta'ala is ghafir, Allah Ta'ala is ghafur, and Allah Ta'ala is ghaffar. These are different degrees of Allah's ghufran, of Allah's forgiveness but not forgetfulness, jalla fil'ula. Afu is the fourth degree, higher, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives and forgets, obliterates it, yani. You sin, with Allah's afu, the sin's wiped out. Doesn't manifest on the day of judgment. Hilm is when Allah Ta'ala, you bet the si'at al-hasanat, Allah Ta'ala, where he transforms bad deeds into good deeds on the day of judgment. Kayf kalam, you come with bad deeds, Allah will show you, innani halim, I am the halim. All them bad deeds you have are transferred into good deeds, as the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said. A man comes before one of the people, judged before Allah Ta'ala, Musnad of Ahmed ibn Hanbal, that a man comes before Allah Ta'ala, and Allah Ta'ala says, show him his minor deeds, duna kibariha, and not his good deeds, not his major deeds. Show him his minor sins and not his major sins. Show them, he asked the angels, Jibreel and Mikael. So they manifest all of his what? All of his minor deeds. All of his minor deeds. And then the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, the man, for yushfiq ala kibariha, he's like, oh, please don't show the major deeds. Because these are all the minor sins, don't show the major sins. And then the man, the Prophet said, he starts doing this, like looking round on the day of judgment. And Allah Ta'ala says, don't worry, between me and your and the khala'iq is a veil. That's ghufran right there, that's forgiveness, ghufran. I put a veil, it's only me and you, no one else can see it. That's a good sign. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the angels, he says to the angels, now take all of their minor deeds, their minor sins, transform them into good deeds. And every single one of his minor sins are transformed into good deeds. And then the man says, Allah, I have deeds in the li'amal la araha huna. He said, I have deeds that I can't see here. Yeah, he wants to see his bad sins now, his major sins, because Allah can transform them into major good deeds. And then the Prophet began, that's what he put in the chapter of the laughter of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He smiled, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he recounted that tradition, that reality of the Day of Judgment. That's Halim. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam here is Al-Hilm, Sahib Al-Hilm, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Allahu Akbar, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Sahib Al-Hilm. Then when Allah Ta'ala was so concerned about that attribute of Hilm, on the third splitting of the chest of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he was 12 years after prophecy, 52 years of age, when they take out the heart of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Jibreel and Mikael, they wash it with Iman, they wash it with Hikmah, faith and wisdom, and they'd already did that in the two previous splittings of his chest, but this time it's very different. They also wash it with Hilm. The attribute we're speaking about now. What is Hilm? When people do you bad, you do them good. That's what Hilm is called, clemency, to be clement. Allah Ta'ala is the clement. And Allah Ta'ala commands clemency from his slaves. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in the hadith of Zayd bin Seerah, the great rabbi of Medina, who becomes Muslim, that's what he was looking for. He said, Araftu. He said, I knew all of the signs of prophecy in the face of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam alone, except two. The two all related to that one attribute of Hilm. That if you do him bad, he will do you good. And the more bad you do him, the more good he will do you. Ajeeb, huh? It's really, really strange. But the power of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you will take an avowed enemy and turn him into wali and hamim, Allah ta'ala calls him. A warm, protecting friend. You will take people who wanted to kill you, and then you will turn them into people who will die for you. And that's what you see, that's the prophetic life story. You know, Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab is a great example of that. You see, you know, I mean, on the road to Dar al-Arqam, not the road to Damascus, this is a real conversion, true, thoroughbred conversion of Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab, who wants to kill the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then it's Fida and Abi wa Ummi, I would sacrifice my mother and my father for you, Ya Rasulullah. I mean, you are more beloved to me than the entire world, my children, my parents, and what resides between my two sides, Umar ibn Khattab says, Al-An Ya Umar, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, now, you're a true believer, Umar. Take to forgiveness. Yani khudh al-afu. This is not forgiveness, ghufran. This is afu. In the same catechism, we're speaking about to forgive and forget. Khudh al-afu. Wa'mur bil-urfi. Enjoin benevolence. What's benevolence? Urf. What does it mean, urf? That which is well known amongst all prophets. All prophets commanded those same type of attributes, the makarim. Yani wa'arid an al-jahilin. Just turn away from the ignorant people. Don't confront them. Khalas, turn away. Okay? You turn towards Allah Ta'ala, perhaps the ignorant will follow you. God commands justice and goodness and giving to relatives and forbids indecency and abomination and injustice, cautioning you that you may be mindful. As if, you know, we forget that. That's the power. We're all thinking about the Salah and getting back to work on the Jum'ah. Allah bless Sayyidina Umar Abdul Aziz. Sayyidina Umar Abdul Aziz is the one who institutionalizes this. In Allah Ya'mur Yani Bil Ihsan. This is what the Khatib says every Jum'ah, the last words of the Khatib. That's from Sayyidina Umar Abdul Aziz. Because some people, ignorant people, used to get on the minbar and cuss Sayyidina Ali bin Abi Talib, cuss out Ahlul Bayt upon the minbar from Banu Umayyah. And when Umar Abdul Aziz gets into power, becomes the caliph for 2 years, he prevents that and he brings the verse which to this day, and 1300 years later, is still the verse which characterizes the khutbah, the very end of the khutbah. Okay? God commands justice. Ya'mur bil adli wal ihsan wa ita'i dhil qurba. God commands justice and goodness and giving to relatives and forbids indecency and abomination and injustice, cautioning you that you may be mindful. Pray regularly, enjoin what is feared and forbid the unacceptable, and be constant no matter what happens to you, for that is of the resolve that determines affairs. Inna dhalika min azmin umur. Okay? Yet if anyone is patient and forgives, that is determination that will resolve affairs. Attributes, Quranic attributes, all of them we see in the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. All of them, the believers in early Mecca, are now going to be what raid upon. But since they broke their covenant, we cursed them and made their hearts hard. They pervert words from their places, and they have forgot part of what was expounded to them. And you will not cease to encounter treacherous deceit from them, except a minority amongst them. So pardon them and forgive them, for God loves those who act with kindness. Allah Ta'ala is speaking about Jews and Christians here. But still, how are we commanded? That's how they are. We're not commanded to react to that. We're commanded to listen to the commandment of Allah Ta'ala. Pardon them. Forgive them. And afu. And what? And ghufran. Allah loves those who act with kindness, Allah Ta'ala says. For good and evil are not equal. Promote what is better. لا يستويان. And then one between you and whom there is enmity will be as a warm, protecting friend. That's Wali al-Hamim. And those who restrain anger are those who forgive people. And God loves those who do good. Attributes. Believers avoid excess imagination, for some imagination is a sin. Inna ba'd al-dhan ithm. And don't spy on each other and don't defame one another in their absence. Would any of you like to eat the flesh of his dead brother? You would hate it, so be conscious of God, for God is most relenting, most merciful. The scoffers put fanaticism in their hearts, the fanaticism of jahiliyyah. But God sent tranquility, hamiyatul jahiliyyah, but God sent tranquility upon his messenger and on the believers and imposed on them the sentence of God, consciousness, kalimatul taqwa, of which they were most worthy and deserving, and God knows everything. Okay? This is our theme, inshallah ta'ala, of good attributes, inshallah ta'ala. We ask Allah ta'ala to bless us with attributes, inshallah ta'ala, as Allah ta'ala created us in the best of forms, as he says, Jalla fil ula, we ask Allah ta'ala to create our internal reality, likewise pleasing to him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Muhammad wa alayhi wa sallam. Anyone have any questions, inshallah ta'ala?
You mentioned three, then splitting of the heart. No. Of the Prophet, I heard of one before, when he was a child and he was in the desert, and the figures of white came, and you mentioned the third one. What was the second one?
The second is 40. Dominant opinion is 40 years of age. A prophecy sent to Jibreel. His heart was split before that. Some also have it. There's also a weak tradition. At 12 years of age, his chest was also split as well. But the dominant opinion is 3 times: 5 years of age, 40 years of age, and what? And 52 years of age.
You mentioned that there were 10 companions. Known to have memorized the Quran. Who are the 10?
Less than 10. Another alim in terms of who they all were. And from amongst them is Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Sa'ud, from amongst them is Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib, from amongst them is Sayyidina Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu ta'ala, and from amongst them is Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas, Abdullah ibn Umar, Umar ibn Khattab. Okay, yeah. All of them, Allah ta'ala. But he mentioned 8 Sahaba who memorized the Quran by memory, complete. Memorization of the Quran. Any further questions, inshallah? Okay.